for the invitation speaker. So, I want to talk a bit about the theory of open descendant integrals. So, start with some motivation. Okay, I'll try to do that. motivation. And then something about genus zero. I really want to try to talk about the geometric underpinnings of this theory. And then something about higher genus. So, motivation. So first of all, so a lot of these things are in the archive, but some not. So there's paper, Rahul, self, and Ron Tesler, which establishes a sort of analog of Witten's conjectures. So when I say descendant integrals, what I mean is sort of for, you know, say descendant invariants of the point. So people sometimes call these psi integrals. Or ancestors, or stuff like that. So these are certain intersection numbers on moduli space of curves. But the twist is that instead of looking at the space of stable curves, like happens in Witten's conjectures, for curves with boundary or open, so for people familiar with that theory, there's the open KdV equation, similar to the KdV hierarchy. It's a hierarchy, whatever. And there's an open Virasoro version of the same conjecture. And here, there's a, so this is a kind of conjecture, and there's like a, there's a rigorous construction. In genus zero, and a proof of the conjecture in genus zero. Okay, but the conjecture is kind of like there might exist something, there should exist something in all genera which behaves like this. And so really what I'm going to talk about today is joint work of myself and Tesler in progress, which this is which actually constructs the higher genus theory, open right, decided this has to be abbreviated. OK. comes up too often. ODI. And well, actually, this is still in progress, but it's really inspired by a combinatorial formula which tells you the answer. So, which is already available. So this is a analog of Hansevich's combinatorial model. For open descendant integrals. And there's also another preprint of Tesler, Buryak and Tesler, which shows that this combinatorial model gives, right, there's a matrix model, which in terms of matrix integrals, so then this implies the open Witten conjectures. Okay, so far this is kind of an analog of something which people have had fun with in the closed theory. Why might it interest people at this conference? There's a very recent preprint of Zernick, which shows that you can use, so you can compute, you know, the structure coefficients of the Fukaya infinity algebra. Inside of CP M, in terms of open descendant integrals in genus zero, in okay, so I mean maybe sometimes people are kind of used to thinking of this particular Lagrangian as being sort of trivial in the Fukaya category. On the other hand, it still has, if you consider things over a Novikov ring, so then it becomes has a very rich structure. In particular, you can extract from this a lot of numerical invariants. So this gives you a formula for, say, Welschinger's real numerative invariants. So for and sort of higher dimensional generalization, in the style of some recent preprints of myself and Tukhachinsky. So, and in fact, one could then speculate that similar formulas ought to hold. In fact, one can write down formulas formally. You would like to generalize this to a higher genus. So this is kind of future direction. So. But you can already start to check it formally. So you would like to compute sort of, you know, concrete structure coefficients in a higher genus. So this is, you know, Foucault category, or higher genus open Joel Whitman variants. And finally, there's some work in progress of Guterman and self, where we can use, so this is the only time during the talk I'm going to mention when you have descendants which are not related to the point target. So you can deform the Foucault category. Using descendant classes, and so this leads to so descendant open Gromov of Witten invariants. And TRR, topological recursion relations. And one might hope that if you extend this to higher genus, then you could start to write down something like Virasoro constraints on the higher genus open Gromov Witten invariants, or Foucault category, or something like that. So this is understood for the point, but for like Virasoro. Thanks. So that's somewhat conjectural, but anyway. So these are just some random pieces of motivation. How do you define these numbers? So first of all, genus 0. So we have, first of all, there's some M0KL is going to be just the space of disks. So stable disks. So this means you allow sort of bubbling and do a, you can have spheres which bubble, or you can have disks which bubble, something which is pretty familiar to people working with the Foucault category. So you have stable disks, but there's no maps, right? So that's the thing. So you don't have any maps at all. You just have the domains of the sort of J-homomorphic curves, which you usually count in the Foucault category. So you have stable disks with k boundary marked points and L interior marked points. So in general, you might think of something like this. You have a disk and, you know, joined to another disk by some node. And then you could have a whole tree of such disks. You might also have some spheres bubbling off from the interior and, you know, various trees of such spheres. This is a stable disk. But the open strata, and then of course you have lots of marked points. So you have boundary marked points. And you also have some interior marked points. Many of them. OK, so this is the sort of moduli space we want to talk about. And the dimension of this thing is k plus 2l minus 3. This comes from the automorphism group of the disk. This is the dimension of PSL to R, which is the automorphisms of the disk. And over this space, you have some tautological line bundles. So Li is a tautological line bundle. So that means that if you look at Li over some stable disks, sigma is the Riemann surface, and I should have said sigma is the Riemann surface, and then k boundary marked points will be sort of x1 up to xk, and L interior marked points z1 up to zl. So if you look at the fiber of this line bundle over a stable marked disk, it's just going to be the cotangent space to the disk at the ith interior marked point. So you have two different brands of marked points, and so these guys are the, this is Z1, this is ZL. You have X1 up to XK. And so we only consider the interior marked points because basically, if you look at a boundary marked point, then the cotangent space is going to be the complexification of the cotangent space to the boundary. And when you have a line bundle, which is a complexification, its Chern classes, which we're going to be interested in, are going to be, well, its first Chern class is the only one that you have, is going to naturally just be torsion. So it's not a good thing if you're trying to get numbers. So what we want to do is we want to look at some integrals of say C1 of L1 to the A1 up to C1 of L to the A. Okay, and so this is a complex line bundle, and this is its first Chern class, and this integral is not defined because well, this thing is a should have said over here. It's a smooth manifold with corners. Just a manifold. So if you take just the Chern class of Li, then it belongs to the absolute cohomology of this moduli space. And in order to integrate something over the moduli space, it needs to belong to the relative cohomology. Okay, and the trouble is you can't get this. At least we don't know any way to naturally promote the first Chern class of these tautological lines to live in relative cohomology.
Yes? You just told us that if you were to corresponding line bundle would be.
That's right. But the boundary of the moduli space is not the boundary of the surface.
Good. Thank you.
Okay. You're not the first person to ask that question. Okay, so maybe I should repeat that more slowly. Yes. I'm going to give a pictorial example. Okay. So I mean, I don't know what it means when there would actually be a problem, because there's, you know, many different ways of sort of like, you know, ad hoc defining this in many different specific situations. But how to you want to lift this, right? So. So in particular, the boundary of MKL of this moduli space of stable disks is just not equal to what you might think at first. So I mean, one thing that can happen as you get to as you know, one way of this boundary happening is that one of the interior mark points travels until it bumps into the boundary of the disk. So I should say it's contained, but not equal to the set of disks, say, like where you have a bunch of interior marked points and a bunch of boundary marked points. And one thing that could happen is
the other direction for contained.
Oh, is thank you. It contains but does not equal the set of disks where, say, one interior marked point travels towards the boundary, and this is, you know, this. So you know, you could have a case where you have many marked points on a boundary. You could have this together with, you know, some interior marked points and some boundary marked points. And so if you had just this situation, then this then the tautological line bundle on this part of the boundary is clearly going to be the complexification of a real bundle, and you're good. But if you say have an additional boundary marked point on that component. Then I don't know. It's not clear exactly what you'd want to do. So, for example, you could have. I'm going to work out just in complete explicit detail how this definition that I'm going to give works in the case of three boundary marked points and one interior marked point. And I hope that some idea of what is generally going on here will become clear. But So you could have this kind of thing. You could have a boundary marked point along with interior marked point. And this, it's not really clear how this would, you know, this means that basically this means that a boundary marked point, you had a whole bunch of guys, and then one of them decided to travel to the boundary of the disk. And then when it hit the boundary of the disk, it bubbled off onto this disk. Okay, so this is one thing that happens in the boundary of the moduli space, which is clearly the same sort of like this boundary point bumping into the boundary of the disk. But then it could also happen by, say, an interior marked point bumping into a boundary marked point. So you could have some particular interior marked point, which then bumps into here. And then when you look at this boundary, there's like this is a one-dimensional. So there are different ways that you can bump into this point from the perspective of the moduli space. It depends at what direction you approach this point. And as you change the direction from which you approach, you're going to move this point back and forth in this disk component. And you have to say exactly how you trivialize the line bundle as this point moves back and forth. And so the direction. So the direction here matters. And it's reflected in where this point is relative to the other two boundary points. It extends. It's perfectly well defined. But you want to lift it. You want to somehow trivialize it over the boundary of the moduli space.
Yes, not trivial on the boundary. That seems like the
relation. Yes, that's exactly. So we want to make this lift. So I should have said i.e., somehow trivialize it. So this lift.
Like if you weren't using this, if you were using e1 with points, this wouldn't be true that it lives in this relative.
Right, but see this, when I say the boundary here, this is actually a boundary in the topological sense of a boundary. It's not like a codimension 2 boundary like you have in the case of complex curves. So this is like, this is a codimension 1 boundary. So I'm going to draw like my favorite example space in a few minutes. So it is contained but not, there's it's contained but not equal to. There's like a lot of ways of orienting these different parts of the symbol, and they're somehow all get jumbled up. And
again, the statement was that when you consider this family where one boundary confesses to the extra component and there's no sensible trace of the existence.
Right. So, I mean, maybe there is in this particular example one you could cook up, but I don't see how to extend any kind of reasonable thing to the general setting, except for what I'm going to tell you.
And you're just saying it's not clear.
It's not at all clear. Yeah, so not clear. yes?
Can you say anything about how big H2 and H1 of the boundary actually are?
I mean, why would that help?
The obstruction space and the unique.
okay, I see what you mean.
You need everything to be coherent.
Well, of course, but
you have a lot of. So H1 is generally not going to be trivial. That much I can tell you. So in the first example I show you, it's not going to be trivial. So the only example, probably, at the rate I'm going. But what am I going over here for? I just finished that. So, okay. So, for those who like the Foucault category, I'm going to say something which sounds a little bit ad hoc, but I think the true interpretation of this, which is coming out in this work I mentioned, joint with Gitterman, PhD student right now, and it basically interprets what I'm going to say as being a sort of a way of making the descendent Foucault category be cyclic and unital. So there's some sort of forgetful mumbo jumbo which I have to do, and it has to do with a certain unitality condition.
I think cyclic is the issue.
Well, I mean, suppose you have two. Suppose you have, instead of this example, you have, I don't know, say you have two marked points coming on, two interior marked points coming on the same boundary, on the same disk, or maybe your boundary marked point is some other disk, which is, I mean, Well, I think maybe the worst case is when you have. Well, I guess, yeah, but suppose you have like two, suppose you have another interior mark point sort of like intervening between you and the root, then, I mean, the line bundle is going to twist as you go over this mark point, and I'm not quite exactly sure what you mean.
So if two points, if you have a component that's a two sphere, right, and your slice on there, that could also be part of the boundary, and there you don't know which way to point.
Yeah, you can have something like this.
All possible ways point towards the axis. And that was the monodrop he was talking about, when you have two points running around each other.
Something like that, maybe. Somehow I think, I mean, here this, what you were saying, could in theory be made to work, but I think here it would be more difficult to do something like that. So this is where like two boundary point, two interior points run into each other and bump into the boundary at the same time. All right. So we have to somehow promote this this integral, sorry, these classes to relative cohomology, and we don't know how to do that. But on the other hand, so. The following little trick, take E is the sum of these line bundles, direct summed with themselves a bunch of times, and then the Euler class of E is equal to the product of these. First turn classes. And so actually all we have to do is lift the Euler class to relative cohomology. So since we're after, since we're just interested in various products where the degree of this cohomology class is equal to the dimension, so we can then integrate. So here of course you have to have, you know, sum of these guys. This is the degree of right, AI times the degree. Sorry, yeah. This is the degree of the integrand. It's got to be equal to the dimension of the space over which you're integrating. So the Euler class is then equal to this thing. It suffices. So this is actually equal to the integral of the Euler class of E over M0K L. Okay, so it suffices to promote the Euler class of E from absolute cohomology, where it naturally lives, to, so we want to lift it to relative cohomology, which maps to that. OK. And the way we can do that is, so the claim is there exists a canonical up to homotopy, nowhere vanishing section of this E. Choose a nowhere vanishing section of E restricted to 0KL. And then then you can define the relative Euler class of E with respect to S is equal to the Poincaré dual to, say, some extension intersected with the zero section, where so S tilde is a section of E extending S to the entire moduli space. Yes. So I haven't told it yet. I'm going to right now. And well, this is really going much slower than I expected. So E. So this belongs to relative cohomology. So this whole cohomology class, relative cohomology class, it depends only on so it's independent. It doesn't change if we change S by nowhere vanishing homotopy. Another inspiration, by the way, of what I'm going to say. So I mean, the thing is that there are many different choices, even up to nowhere vanishing homotopy. Still, a priori, many choices. So we have to choose a kind of canonical one. So there always exists. So there, you can always choose such a nowhere vanishing section because the dimension of this, the rank of this bundle is always bigger than the dimension of this guy by one, because here you assume, right? So rank of E is equal to the dimension of M. Okay, so then here, did I make another bad permutation of symbols?
Be a great moment to have a cliffhanger and say this will be resolved next season. No, go ahead.
dear me. so this is here, the rank of E is equal to M plus 1. So you can always do that. So there's okay, so we know that if we look at a component of this boundary, okay, you can always. So you just look at, I mean, it's a boundary of manifold corners. You basically get a whole bunch of manifolds with corners. So it's going to be, you know, more or less canonically up to some silly choices, is going to be so to some product of m0 k1 plus 1 l1 times M0 K2 plus 1 L2, where K1 plus K2 is equal to K, L1 plus L2 is equal to L, and the picture is something like this will the top stratum of this will consist of pairs of disks, and you'll have, say, x1 prime up to xk1 prime, and here you'll have, say, x1 prime prime up to xk2 prime prime, and then you'll have a bunch of interior marked points as well. And you also have two extra marked points, which come from the node, okay? Which is why you have plus one. So here's where the plus one comes from. Okay. Now, you look at the sort of dimension, which, so we know that 2 times another blackboard. So observation is that so we know that this rank of the bundle is equal to this is rank E, is equal to 2L minus plus K minus 3. All right, so this is the dimension of the moduli space. But now, mod 2, this says that K is odd. So then that means that without loss of generality, you can assume that K1 is odd, let's say, and K2 is even. Well, it's funny that you ask, because there is actually a relation between the genus 0 integrals I'm defining now and the lambda g, lambda g minus 1 integrals on mg. We'll have to talk about that afterwards, because I mean, there's a coincidence between certain numerical formulas between. Anyway, there's this observation. And so the idea is that we can now, because K1 is odd, in particular, it's always not 0. So you can always forget it. And it turns out you never destabilize anything when you forget it. So you can forget the node. Without destabilizing a component containing Zi. But since K1 is odd, and K1 plus 1 is the total number of marked points, we're good.
But what if you're
so,
okay, sorry, K1 plus 1, yes, okay, yes.
What if you're on the boundary of this boundary?
You have to check, but it turns out that it works.
Okay, but then
I mean, I'm only working codimension 1, and it's a bit more complicated combinatorial to work higher codimension, but we have to, of course, in order to construct things. It's just, but it turns out things work out. I'm not trying to say this is trivial. So then what we do is we just look at this map, which goes from So I mean, why is it important that we don't destabilize a component? Because we want to be able to sort of pull back our bundle from a same bundle down below. K1 plus 1 L1 times N0 K1 K2 plus 1 L2 project to N0 K1. And now we have not plus 1. So this is forget one side of node. OK, and K2. Now we have plus 1, L2. OK, and then the main point is that if we call this pi, then here you have the bundle E, and there is a kind of E a hat, which is the same thing, just over this smaller moduli space with one less boundary marked point, still Li to the Ai. OK, and the point is that you do shouldn't push it up so quickly. Since it doesn't destabilize anything, actually E is equal to it's canonically isomorphic to the pullback of E hat. Yeah. Oh. Okay. So implies that E is canonically isomorphic to, so you can look up there and see the beginning of what I was writing, and then look down here, and just for the context. I mean, OK, so it's because of that not destabilizing that you actually have this canonical isomorphism. And what we say, so definition S is canonical if S is equal to pi pullback of S hat. There exists some S hat. Sorry, I should say that. If for each boundary component, probably I should move to the next board. Oh dear. We really ran out of time. Okay, so I'm not getting to higher genus at all. Sorry. But I will draw a picture. So at least you see why it's interesting to go to higher genus, because I'm using genus 0 very strongly here. So for each boundary component, B, component of this thing, so then there exists S hat, a section of E hat, such that S is equal to pi star of S hat. Okay, and the point of this is that, so the theorem is that this is Pantare Pande, myself, Tesler, that there exists a canonical you have to make it multi-valued, multi-section. I mean, there exists a canonical multi-section, and it's unique up to non-vanishing, a nowhere vanishing, which is unique up to nowhere vanishing homotopy. All right, so then you can make sense of this Euler class. So just repeat, the M0KL are actually sort of smooth manifolds with corners. There's no isotropy or anything like that. So the reason you need multi...
This class is rational.
The reason you need to have a multi-section is because as you move around the different faces of the moduli space and you observe this canonicity definition, you actually have some kind of monodromy as you move from one face to another. And in fact, when you have five boundary points and one interior mark point, you can actually write down explicitly that you have to have at least three branches to your multi-section. And you can write down a series of 10 faces over which there's non-trivial monodromy, which comes back and rotates your section by third root of unity. So I was going to do that today, but I don't have time to do the simpler example. So I'm going to do the simpler example.
Jake, I have a question. So so the boundary is this product and this ingredients of the product decompose further. Is there some kind of algorithm to start really very low?
Yes.
You say to go from one step to the other, what you have to do.
Exactly. So you have to start from the lowest dimensional stratum, and you work up stratum by stratum. And you have to inductively construct this multi-section. And you really need to work somewhat hard to do that. And I guess at the current stage, the only way we can do that is using some techniques which are in the book of Helmut on developed for polyfold theory. But it's not trivial to extend multi-sections from the boundary of a manifold with corners. Even when it's a smooth manifold with corners, it's fine dimensional and compact and so on and so forth. So,
Jake, I'm still confused by one thing. So the rank of E compared to the dimensions of the individual moduli spaces where you're working on now is quite a bit bigger.
Right, so now this is two more. And that's exactly, so I'm going to just, I was about to say this. So it's unique because so E hat is dimension two more than this product here. Once you dimension two more, then any two choices you make will be non-vanishing homotopy. So then if you take a 0, 1 times this thing, and then it's going to be one less than this. And so then you can just take any two non-vanishing S hats and connect them by non-vanishing homotopy. And that can be lifted up to a non-vanishing homotopy up in the for S. So this uniqueness is because the rank of E hat is equal to the dimension of M0K1 L1 times M0K2 plus 1 L2 plus 2. OK, so then any two no-vanishing sections can be homotopped by non-vanishing, nowhere-vanishing section. So actually, I learned this idea from Melissa Liu's thesis, where there's a kind of an S1 action, which quotients out the boundary of the moduli space. And I kind of see this as being a kind of topological version of that S1 action. So that's another motivation for this. Well, when you go around the whole thing, the leaves kind of close up. And it becomes an S1 action topologically. But all right, so anyway, I have to give you one example. So let's consider the example where we just look at the integral of L1 over M. So C1 of L1, or I should say Euler of L1 with respect to a canonical modal section over M0, 3, 1. All right, so what does this moduli space look like? So the dimension of M0, 3, 1 is equal to 3 plus 2 times 1 minus 3 is equal to 2. And that gives us a hexagon. So this is actually a smooth manifold with corners. And this sort of dense open stratum inside is all sorts of disks which look like, so this whole thing is supposed to be M031. And inside we have just a disk with three marked points and one, three boundary marked points and one interior marked point. So X1, X2, X3, Z1. All right, and then so you can just sort of imagine that these three boundary marked points are fixed in one position because you can always move them around by using the PSL2 action. Then the interior marked point can move around and bump into the boundary and bump into the marked points on the boundary, and you get different kinds of bubbling. So here, for example, you get let's just draw this. Okay. So here you get the case where the interior marked point bumps into the boundary marked point, and you get this guy, x1, x2, and then x3, that's z1. And then here you can have x1, x2, x3, and this sort of thing. Then in between, of course, you can have x3 like that. And then up here, maybe go down here. No, better here. OK, so here we have x3, x1, x2. All right. And now I have to say what happens to the boundary condition. So, so the simple case of the boundary condition is when you are in a situation where the boundary, where the interior point just bumps into a boundary component. So then one way to think about it is you just say, well, we'll have the, so this, so what you're going to do is you're going to forget this. So here, k1, so k1 here is equal to 3, k2 is equal to 0. And so you're going to just wind up forgetting this node. And that means that you're just pulling back from a zero-dimensional moduli space. And you know, you can just imagine that this is your section S. It's just pointing in some fixed direction. Let's say outward. Okay, so then as you move along this boundary component, your fixed section S is going to just be pointing outward. Okay, but something more interesting will happen when you move to this boundary component. So here you have, this will be k1 is equal to 1. We always choose the odd one for k1. And k2 is equal to 2. So we're going to forget over here instead. And so then, well, you have to look at the limiting situation. So as you go over here, so then this is going to be pointing out. S is going to be pointing out. But then as you smooth this, so it's pointing out. Well, when you smooth this, it's going to wind up being, to draw one more picture, like very close to this corner. I'm out of time. Let me just finish the picture then without drawing another picture. So what happens here is you wind up pointing always to here. But this starts by sort of, you wind up pointing always to here. And so this starts, but you're pointing away from this one. And I was going to explain that in that picture, but this will have to wait for question period. So what happens is you start, I'm going to mess up the directions, but so you start going, and then you twist. Like this. And then, okay? And this is just by this forgetfulness condition. And so you're going to do the same thing on every place where you bump into a boundary component without a mark point, you're going to go straight. And every place where you bump into a boundary point, you're going to twist once. And then this leads to the answer that this guy is equal to. You're going to rotate once for what would happen if you had no bumping into boundary mark points. And then you're going to go the other time, it's actually a minus, and then you're going to go plus 3 for each time you bump into a boundary mark point. And then you get equal to 2. And so this is not you expect from the dilettante equation. It's kind of modified by the boundary mark points. So there's a modified version of the dilettante equation which occurs in this theory. And stop there.